My name is Ian Shapiro, and I'm an expert neither on China nor on China's place in the world. And just speaking as an outsider, I found President Hu's remarks in some respects encouraging and in some respects less so. On the one hand, he did speak about people-centered development. He spoke about environmentally development that's environmentally sensitive. He spoke about peace and democracy in China, and but on the other hand, he made it clear that China has no interest in aggressive intervention from outside. He made it clear that China is going to pursue its own distinctive political reforms and not borrow models from elsewhere. And while he welcomed those who intend to participate in China's harmonious development, he also said that those who did not want to participate would be strongly resisted. How one unpacks these different terms and whether one considers them to be euphemisms for more complex sets of policies, I'm not qualified to judge. But let me say that the panelists we have here today most certainly are qualified to judge. We will proceed in the order as it was advertised on the program. Each of our initial speakers, I will introduce all of them in a minute. They will speak for roughly 10 minutes at the start of the session. We will then begin some discussion, and the way we will proceed with the discussion will be as follows. We will collect up four or five questions at a time from the audience, and that we will have microphones here, and people will be able to come and state their questions. And then I'll give the panelists individually a chance to take up any of the questions to which they think they may be able to speak. It is a session in which there are questions from the floor to be directed at the panelists. However, what will be out of order will be speeches from the floor. So I will be looking for questions rather than speeches when we get to that part of the proceedings. So let me just say a little bit about the five speakers who are going to be structuring our discussion and responding to questions. Deborah Davis will speak first. She's a professor of sociology, a member of the National Committee on U.S.-China Relations, and former chair of the Yale Council of East Asian Studies. She will address China, urban, rural, and family agendas. She'll be followed by Professor Paul Gewirtz, the Potter Stewart Professor of Constitutional Law and Director of the China Law Center and former Special Representative for the Presidential Rule of Law Initiative for the U.S. State Department. That's the Rule of Law Initiative in China, needless to say. And he will speak about China and the rule of law. He will be followed by Harold Koh, who is Dean of the Yale Law School and former Assistant Secretary of State for Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor, and he will speak about China and human rights. Then we will turn to Professor Francis Rosenbluth from the Department of Political Science, and also Director of the Leitner Center on Political Economy at YCIAS. And she will talk about China, views from her neighbors, focusing particularly on the region around China. And then finally, Ernesto Zedeo, professor of the Yale, director of the Yale Center for the Study of Globalization, former president of Mexico, and professor in the field of international relations, will speak on China and globalization. So that's the batting order, and without further ado, I will turn to Professor Davis.
Thank you, Ian. The title actually advertised is Rising Expectations of China, and that is indeed what I'm going to speak to. And I will primarily talk about the domestic aspect of this revolution of expectations among Chinese citizens, but I first wanted to flag the rising expectations of China on the world scene, and just mention two things that were, I thought, impressed on all of us this morning. I think that we've seen in the Hu visit that Americans and others in Western Europe in particular expect more of Chinese leaders than they did 5 years ago. We see that, I think, in the way that Hu responded to Ernesto Zedillo's question about the criticism of the one-party state. And I was impressed that Hu was as relaxed as he was and the way in which he spoke to the issue. And the second way in which I think we see rising expectations of Chinese officials, not necessarily at the level of Hu, but of delegates in international organizations, is where we see, for example, right now, the efforts on parts of journalists and government negotiators to have China take a role on Darfur, that they are involved in centrally in the six-party talks in North Korea is not quite as surprising, not quite fitting this rising expectations. Although if we took it back 10 years, I think even their key role in these negotiations around the North Korean issues would also signal how expectations of Chinese participation have also risen. The third is that people expect Chinese citizens, those are outside of China, I think expect more of Chinese citizens politically and the way they are going to articulate their opinions and the strategies that they apply. And again, we certainly saw evidence of that this morning. I don't think anyone in the United States was very surprised to see the level of mobilization on the streets of New Haven. I don't think that the delegation from China was actually very surprised. I'm sure they were prepared. But for me, these types of mobilizations by Chinese citizens, which have now become routinized, also is evidence of the way in which the world is expecting as at leadership level and Chinese citizens to play a different role in public life, in international public life. Now I'm going to address, I guess, my brief, which is primarily the domestic scene in China. And I'm just going to highlight four areas in which we see very major shifts in people's expectations of their government and for themselves. I'm going to talk briefly about the job situation, then healthcare, then the media, and finally about certain population issues. The first issue is rising expectations for better jobs. China has now very quickly moving towards a service-oriented economy. It is still a country in which almost half the people are engaged in agriculture. A significant number have industrial jobs, although that's been true for quite some time. What's accelerating and changing the entire economy is a shift actually to a almost post-industrial job structure at the same time as industry is one of the first steps out of farming. And this is very difficult. It is a huge population. Many more people are entering the job market than for whom there are jobs. And yet there is rising expectation of what employment should be. It is not going to be adequate for people to remain on the farm working with pre-modern instruments, living at subsistence. And this is a huge challenge. And of course, it's pushing the government in directions, new directions, and pushing them harder than they have been pushed before. The move out of farming is well discussed, and we can talk about it more. The move for industrial labor is quite complicated. This factory of the world image is actually primarily in greenfield types of industries in the South, where many people are working more than 12 hours a day and working 7 days a week. It is a very, very intense kind of employment with poor protection, and it's a kind of industrial employment actually that's much more demanding and disagreeable than industrial employment used to be in China, and workers are pushing back. The other area builds directly on what Hu said today when he and President Levin talked about this extraordinary gain in numbers of people who are gaining tertiary education. In fact, China last year reached 20% of the age group at tertiary education. The other side of that is now very significant unemployment among college graduates. 62% of those with the tertiary, not the elite university degrees, have jobs. 40% don't. This is very serious, and these graduates have rising expectations. So that's one piece of the rising expectation part of the puzzle. The second is on the healthcare. China now has life expectancies comparable to OECD countries. In urban China, life expectancies are higher than they are in the United States. What this means is that the Chinese population is not just looking for emergency care and gains over infectious diseases. They are looking for actually high-end care, and they have how to deal with chronic conditions. This is playing out in a situation in which China's gone from a situation with about 85% of the population, 90% of the population covered by health insurance, to one where about 15% of the population is covered. So expectations are rising, and the financial structure is not in place to really provide the insurance. And this is another place in which the government is being pushed by the population. The third area is the one that gets a lot of discussion, and that's on the transparency of the media. And the story of the 90s is a dramatic increase in the number of television stations, the number of journals, the number of local newspapers, and then with the internet revolution, China opening up to the web. 140 million people in the last 6 months are regularly logging on. That's a lot, of course. As Hu Jintao reminded us, if you divide this by 1.3 billion, it may not be quite as impressive. It is very impressive. And I'll just flag one more example that came up in with Pei Minxin on the NewsHour day before yesterday. He just came back from Shanghai, where he was trying out the new Google, which of course has gotten a lot of criticism. But one of the things he discovered in playing around with Google in China, in Chinese, is there is a built-in translation program that works extremely well, almost instantaneously, allowing these 140 million Chinese web users to actually surf the World Wide Web regardless of the language in which the news is flowing. Clearly, this further raises expectations of citizens of China. The last piece is on demography. There are two pieces. One is the migration. In this room, I think almost all of us know that in China there is an internal passport system, the Hukou registration system, which discriminates against people born in rural areas getting the full benefits of life in the cities. The Chinese have gradually been pushing this back. There are only a few areas of the country where it really, really restricts people's opportunities. On the other hand, if you saw the piece by Yardley last week in Chongqing, where the parents of a daughter who had only the rural hukou was denied the full compensation when she was killed in the automobile accident, it also pervades people's sense of fairness and equity. This is also an issue which is coming to a head. The Chinese government has said they will have eliminated possibly these hukou by the Olympics. The population is pushing them very hard. They do have a rising expectation of full mobility across their country. And the last demographic piece where expectations are changing dramatically is with the one-child policy. For 2 years, a blue ribbon group of sociologists, demographers, and family planners in China and out with demographers who work outside of China have asked Hu Jintao and the others at that level to reconsider the one-child policy. The one-child policy has resulted in a dramatic distortion of the gender ratio in China. The question now is 23 million men may never find brides, etc. It is a pressing issue among the Chinese population, and this is also a case where we see rising expectations of what Chinese citizens expect of their government and for their futures. And so I would just end by saying that I find that this lens of looking at the rising expectations of ordinary citizens in China, of their leaders and of their hopes for their own personal future, is actually in line with one of Hu's main themes, which, if you heard his presentation this morning, one of the constant themes was the initiative, ingenuity, and perseverance of the Chinese people as really the driving force behind its China's past accomplishments and also its present developmental path. And I think that he and I are on the same wavelength there in looking to the expectations of the citizens as one of the primary drivers for where China will go in the next 5 to 10 years.
Professor Gewirtz.
Thank you. My topic is China and the rule of law, and let me begin with a very clear statement. The phrase rule of law is a much debated term, but by any reasonable definition, China today is not a rule of law society. Even President Hu this morning spoke only of China's efforts to further, I'm quoting, further the strategy of running the country according to law. And he didn't claim that China is today a rule of law society. There is widespread corruption, incompetence, procedural unfairness in the courts, torture by the police, and arbitrary detention are all too common. Legal standards are often absent or vague. Actions of the government are often arbitrary and without basis in law. Dissidents are punished harshly and summarily. And these and other deficiencies in the legal system in China are not just individual stories or individual abuses. They reflect deeper institutional and political realities in China, by which I mean that legal institutions for deciding individual disputes and for checking state power are often weak or lack independence. And some of the problems that I've identified are connected to China's current political system. And with China, there are always buts. Like everything else, the reality is complicated. And along with that disturbing news, I find considerable good news concerning China and the rule of law. There's no doubt that in the last 25 years, China has very much improved its legal system and moved noticeably along the spectrum, at least, from rule of man toward rule of law. After a long period in which China's leaders devalued law and saw law as an obstacle to their goals, they now place very considerable emphasis on the role of the legal system in promoting China's developments. Part of this reflects a concern about economic development and an acceptance of the view that a legal system is needed for economic development, so you need to have contract law, company law, securities law, and so forth. But I think the motivation of the leaders is goes beyond just a concern for economic development. In trying to build a stronger legal system. I think they are trying to avoid some of the abuses of the Cultural Revolution. I think they're concerned themselves about reining in wayward bureaucracies. I think they're concerned about fighting corruption and crime more effectively and see a legal system as connected to that. I think they're responding to a rights consciousness that's growing among the people. I think they're interested in developing peaceful and orderly mechanisms for resolving social disputes that modernization is producing and see legal system reform as contributing to that and thus to greater stability in society. And they're trying to use tools of legal regulation themselves to deal with some of the social issues that are coming up from their modernization, such as environmental law and food safety law and other kinds of regulation that through law that is necessary because of their own modernization efforts. So there is, I think, a motivation among the leaders to strengthen the legal system and improve it, and there is growing space for legal reformers. I won't say growing space. There is genuine space for legal reformers in China today. What are some of the important changes that have taken place? Well, let me just give you two statistics, which for me at least summarize some of the scale of the change concerning law in China. In 1979, there were only two law schools in China. Today, there are over 100. In 1979, there were only 2,000 lawyers in China. Now there are 150,000, approximately. There are a vast number of new laws. They get churned out at the central level and at the provincial and local level at a furious pace. Many legal institutions have been established out of the records from the Mao era. Courts have become more professionalized. Lawsuits have mushroomed, including lawsuits against the government. And statistics show that more than 20% of these lawsuits against the government are won by the people who file the lawsuits. Administrative bureaucracies have become more law-based and more transparent. Let me just give you two examples of things that I think are not widely known outside of China, but are significant signs of this within the administrative bureaucracies. One is the development of more open government, what we would call freedom of information. This is a hot new idea in China, and in reality, there is much more open government information and transparency and regulations that guarantee openness and transparency. And second, there are mechanisms of public participation. To me, one of the most interesting phrases that President Hu used this morning as he was discussing his concept of democracy briefly was the emphasis he placed on developing mechanisms of public participation, not elections, of course, but public participation in the development of laws and rules and regulations. The Chinese Constitution has been amended to provide for governing the country according to law. That makes it ideologically and politically correct to focus and to utilize phrases about legal reform. And you heard President Hu himself invoke issues of legal reform and ruling the country according to law in his speech this morning. Ideas about law and legality are filtering into the political culture and into the public consciousness. There is a growing bottom-up rights consciousness. I think this is connected to what Deborah was saying about rising expectations. There is public pressure for legal reform. Indeed, debates about the legal system in China are often the place where political debate is had because it is politically easier often to discuss issues of state power and individual rights as issues of law or legal issues rather than political issues. So those are some of the signs, positive signs, that I see. And an important factor in all of this and a reason to think that further reforms are possible is that there are now many reformers pushing for legal reform in China. These reformers are sometimes outside of the government, professors at law schools, activist lawyers. They're sometimes in the government. There are many people in the government who are pushing for legal reform. They often face obstacles, of course, but they are often very effective. And these reformers, by the way, are eager often to use, to consult with foreign experts and to use foreign experience as a guide in their reform. That's one of the things that our China Law Center at the law school does. We help work with China's reformers, providing them foreign expertise that might assist them in the reform process. So the story of China and the rule of law, I think, like so much else about China, is complicated. On the one hand, law continues to be an instrument by which the government and the party maintain their monopoly on power. On the other hand, the party's own interest in successful economic reform and in winning broader public support have led it to improve the legal system and even to limit state power through the kinds of laws that I mentioned that give citizens the rights to sue the government. Moreover, I think we see a trend of the party and the state seeing law as an important means of mediating some of the increasingly diverse interests in Chinese society and promoting stability. And the leaders cannot ignore the press for rights protection that its own reform policies, I think, have set in motion. Basically, I see a positive trend in legal development in China, but I certainly have no illusions that the steps towards further progress will be any easier than they've been in the past, and I think the outcome is not certain because of the contradictions that I mentioned earlier. What is certain is that to study this issue of law in China and to work with Chinese legal reformers is fascinating. And also what's certain is that the outcome of the effort to promote legal reform in China is going to be very important for both China and the rest of us. Thank you.
Professor Carr.
Anyone who watches China's human rights situation quickly comes to three conclusions. First, by any objective standard, human rights situation in China is abysmal. Secondly, we're not going to help improve that by ignoring it. We have to talk about it, and we have to raise it directly with the Chinese at every available opportunity, as President Bush did yesterday. But third, in the long run, the strategy that's most likely to help bring China's human rights situation into the 21st century is not being an ineffectual bad cop, trying to get leverage on one-sixth of humanity with isolation or sanctions. But neither should we play the role of uncritical cheerleader. What we have to do is focus on a combination of carrots and sticks, dialogue and declaration, and use an inside-outside approach that combines internal persuasion with external pressure. So let me elaborate on these three points, the situation and the way to address it, and the inside-outside approach. First, everything Paul Gewirtz and Deborah Davis said is true. There is much greater freedom in various ways, particularly economic freedom, but still the average Chinese has strikingly little access to information, strikingly little freedom to make critical decisions affecting their own lives, including such basic rights as the right to speak, worship, to work in a union or participate in political life, to determine what they hear on the radio or watch on TV, or even to choose how many children they're going to have or whether to reveal their sexual orientation. And those groups in China that openly espouse an alternative faith or philosophy, be they the Falun Gong, the Uyghur Muslims, or the Tibetan Buddhists, are brutally suppressed. Now, to be specific, there are six particular areas everyone should be aware of, which are areas of human rights concern and violation under President Hu Jintao. First, freedom of expression and democratic participation. This is a well-known story. Through various kinds of laws and regulation, freedom of expression is strongly controlled. Editors and journalists engage in extensive self-censorship. Communication inside and also externally is restrained. The internet is the cutting edge of this, where the Ministry of Public Affairs is monitoring internet users and increasingly trying to use internet service providers from outside, like Google or Google or Yahoo, to act as either censors or, in some cases, like the Xi Tao case, to actually provide information about individuals who are engaging in various kinds of publication activities. This has led to extensive self-censorship. Take, for example, Just check out in Wikipedia the description of the massacre at Tiananmen Square, which was massively revised, most believe in response to a self-censorship effort, or terms like Tibet or Falun Gong, which you can see on Google outside, you cannot see on Google inside. This is combined with lack of political participation and lack of progress toward national elections and restraints on those who would petition the government directly. A second area is deprivation of freedom of thought, conscience, and religion, particularly with those who are not part of the registered religions. In particular, Tibetan Buddhists and Uyghur Muslims have been linked to separatist efforts, and in the case of the Uyghurs, called terrorists, allowing the global war on terrorism to be used as a rubric for attacking them. And then you have the stunningly brutal and misguided crackdown against the Falun Gong. In their wisdom, the Chinese government has managed to turn a peaceful meditation and exercise group consisting largely of middle-aged party loyalists into a global human rights activist movement by, instead of leaving them alone, cracking down on them in an absolutely brutal and unjustified way, and trying to cover this by calling them a cult, and then saying to us, well, you have your cults too, and we have to work together to stop these cults. A third area is detention and torture, about which Paul said quite a bit. Obviously, the detentions that are going on are based on vaguely defined crimes, such as subversion, endangering state security, or leaking state secrets. We all know the famous case of Zhao Yan, the former news assistant to the New York Times. What has come to light more recently in the report of the UN Special Rapporteur on Torture, Manfred Novak, is the shocking widespread use of torture in Chinese facilities, as well as rewards for policemen who use torture. This is combined with well-known administrative detention practices and sentencing practices, including re-education through labor, which leads to long-scale detentions without trial or judicial review. And particularly troubling is the recent targeting of HIV/AIDS activists, who obviously are essential people in the prevention of the spreading of AIDS in China, some of whom have been detained and punished. Now, don't be decoyed by the kinds of things that you see. Yesterday, for example, President Bush raised 6 cases, was promised results on 3 of them. This is what, when I was in the State Department, we would call the old 3 steps backward, 1 step forward approach. In other words, you arrest a bunch of people who should never have been arrested, and then when the president comes to visit, you release some, but not all of them. And some you propose to send to the United States, where it looks like you're actually responding, but in fact you're sending human rights activists out of the country, never to return again. So this is the same playbook, and many of the issues and the words that I heard today were exactly what I heard in 1998 through 2001. Other areas, the use of prison and forced labor, and the refusal to allow unionization continues to be a serious problem, as does workplace health and safety. A stunning 130 workers were killed in industrial accidents last year, and those of you who have been to the Three Gorges Dam have seen examples of this as well. And then 2 other areas that have to be mentioned: the appalling conditions in Tibet, where a waiting game is going on. One of the most remarkable people alive today, the Dalai Lama, is trying to engage in dialogue. The Panchen Lama, the younger boy, has been kidnapped, the number 2, and another person is being pushed forward. The original Panchen Lama's birthday is next week. He will be 17. And increasingly, there's an assertion that is the Panchen Lama, the puppet, who will be the legitimate leader of the Tibetan people. And this is an effort, really, to undermine an area of cultural autonomy. And the 6th and final area, treatment of the displaced, particularly internally displaced and refugees. Large-scale forced evictions are going on in Beijing in preparation for the 2008 Olympics, often combined with corrupt activities by local government officials. And North Korean refugees who are fleeing to China are frequently returned into the hands of their persecutors in violation of the Refugee Convention, one of the issues that the president raised yesterday with President Hu. As Paul said quite accurately, the rule of law mechanisms for correcting these problems do not exist nearly to the extent that they should. And this is combined, this repression at home, with hostility to human rights abroad. The people of Darfur have paid a great price for this through China's massive investment in Sudanese oil. And I think we should all be proud that here at Yale they have divested from Sinopec, which was one of the key sponsors. Promotion of human rights violations through funding in Angola, in Zimbabwe, Uzbekistan. China has stood with the military government of Burma, King Gyendra in Nepal, and in Cambodia. So this is all in all a very grim picture. Now, does President Hu get it? He said very familiar things today. He supports human rights according to law. The most promising thing, there shall be no modernization without democracy. But when you had the question from President Zedillo, which was read, what is your strategy for promoting human freedom? His answer was, I am a Marxist, I'm a materialist, I believe in base and superstructure. And then he went on. What he was saying was, I'm not a Westerner. Westerners believe in individual freedom as the basis for government. That is not my starting point. We believe in an economic structure, a political structure to permit that. And frankly, I don't have to have a strategy of promoting human freedom because that's not what we do, and we are not going to follow your game plan. Now, what then to do about it? An inside-outside approach, I think, is the only way that can seriously work. If you have a troublesome neighbor who's quite powerful, you cannot simply threaten them and get leverage on them. You have to use every channel available to try to persuade them to change their conduct, as well as to shame and pressure them as well. And that means pushing from both the inside and the outside to get change from the bottom up. And that means that human rights needs to be pressed with the Chinese in many dimensions, through diplomacy, declarations, sanctions, monitoring, economic linkages, corporate social responsibility, particularly in the 2008 Olympics, and in myriad forms of private engagement. And that's where I think President Levin's remarks about the power of the individual personal encounter is so important. And then combined with that, what Professor Gewirtz said about promoting the rule of law as the opening end of the wedge, and expanding and the space for internal reformers to work, and then supporting those internal reformers. That was a strategy that worked with regard to the Soviet Union, opening up some space for internal debate, and then supporting those people. And then a final part of this message, I have to say, people who live in glass houses shouldn't throw stones. If we're engaged in torture and we're using the war on terror as a vehicle for human rights violations, that's going to get noticed by the Chinese and brought up repeatedly as cover for what they do. All in all, we have to take into account three incentives on the Chinese side. One, their intense desire and pride and interest in status. It may not matter much to us that this was not a state visit. It was an official visit with a lunch, not a dinner at the White House. But I'll tell you, the Chinese were acutely aware of that. That was an appropriate response by the president, and I applaud him for it. Secondly, that we should emphasize their desire for global recognition by saying you cannot be part of the global system unless you play by all the global rules. And finally, their self-interest. It is not in their self-interest to try to enter the world economy with a backward system of law and human rights. So in closing, I think we need to say to the president, as well as to China itself, China can be, it must be a global leader, but only if it plays by global rules. They've started to do that with legal reform in the area of trade. They have to do it in human rights as well. And I think we need to say to President Hu, at a personal level, if you want to be remembered as the leader who brought China into the 21st century, it's in your self-interest to modernize your system and bring it up to global standards. You can be a leader in a 21st century global marketplace, but not if you insist on 19th century attitudes toward human rights and personal freedom. And so at the end of the day, the question that we ask both China and the president is, who are you? Are you going to be remembered as a genuine global leader playing by global rules, or someone who tried to enter a 21st century system with a 19th century attitude toward individual rights. And as the song says, the answer to the question, who are you, is we really want to know.
Professor Rosenbluth.
My mandate is to think about how China's neighbors view China. I'm going to focus mostly on Japan, the biggest one, and the one that feels the most aggrieved at having once been dominant, at least for the last 150 years, and now feeling the tide changing. And I'm going to focus my comments by way of a question that people who are interested in China, I think, are all curious about, and that is, why does the Japanese Prime Minister continue to make official annual visits to Yasukuni Shrine, which is the Shinto shrine memorializing Japanese war dead, that includes the remains, symbolic and actual, of not only foot soldiers, but people who were in command and people who were prosecuted as war criminals, many of them for their actions in China. So this is an irritant in Sino-Japanese relations, and people want to know, why doesn't the Japanese Prime Minister just stop going? This would help Sino-Japanese relations immensely. So what do these visits signify about Japanese politics, Japanese nationalism, Japanese politics in particular? And what do these visits portend for Sino-Japanese relations? And I'm going to go about answering this question by telling you the cast of characters involved in this. The business world, that is the Japanese business leaders, public opinion, Japanese mass opinion, and the Japanese political leadership. So first of all, the Japanese business community. The economic relationship between Japan and China is vibrant. The two countries are deeply intertwined. Japan is the third biggest investor in China after Hong Kong and Korea, and ahead of the US. Japan and China are competing for oil and other resources, but they are also each other's exporters and importers on a very large scale. So there's a lot of interest in the Japanese business community in keeping Sino-Japanese relations on even keel. Okuda, who is the chairman of Toyota Motor Company and also the chairman of the Keidanren, which is the Federation of Business Organizations in Japan, has repeatedly requested the Prime Minister Koizumi to refrain from going to Yasukuni. This is a problem for the Japanese business community and their reception in China. And I just want to point out an interesting parallel between this posture of the Japanese business community and that of pre-war Japanese zaibatsu. In the 1920s, Mitsui and Mitsubishi, very big economic concerns in the Japanese economy, opposed Japanese military incursions against China because they had a big economic stake in continuing to buy and sell in China. They eventually, of course, when the military government took over, adapted and became big manufacturers of military equipment. But in the 1920s and right up until 1932, had resisted the Japanese military stance towards China and pulled out of the South Manchurian Railroad Company for a time. So big business in the pre-war period was not the engine of aggression and expansion, nor is it today the impetus behind this Japanese nationalism as expressed in the Yasukuni visits. Popular opinion, what the average Japanese citizen thinks is more complicated and divided. Divided almost evenly. About 48% of the Japanese approve of the official visits to Yasukuni. About 46% disapprove. And this is a shift of about 10 percentage points
over the last few years in favor of Yasukuni visits. So what does this mean? Well, there is a very strong hardcore veterans group in Japan, about 1.5 million people. But since Japan hasn't been at war since World War II, this is an aging group, and they're not an expanding group. So that's a hardcore component to Japanese nationalism, but that's not what's growing. The increase in support for Yasukuni visits draws heavily from the young people. And the backdrop to this is a pessimistic mood in Japan on account of, in part, the 15 years of economic malaise, the fact that Japan's adjustment to increasing openness and integration with the world economy has not been evenly shared. There's a lot of unemployment, underemployment among the Japanese youth, and this is a group that's especially susceptible to nationalist appeals by politicians courting their votes. The Japanese express what they call apology fatigue. They feel that they've apologized to China for the war. They feel that it hasn't been fully accepted. And you probably know that in the last few years, Japan has made a bid to the membership of the Security Council, which met with a very strong negative reaction, not just from the Chinese government, but massive protests from the Japanese people. And in response to that set of protests, the previously favorable opinion in Japan towards China, which had been about half of the people in Japan expressed very strong or quite strong favorable opinion towards China, dropped to less than 20%. This is just in the last couple of years. So that's the brief sketch of Japanese public opinion, why it's changed, how it's changed. Finally, political leadership in Japan. The current Prime Minister Koizumi and his administration views the United States as the main ballast for Japanese security, and that whatever happens with China is more or less irrelevant, both in the sense that the economies of Japan and China are so strongly linked that the political ruffles on the surface are unlikely to seriously affect the economic relationship, and that in any case, China probably can't be placated. There isn't much more Japan can say or do because the Chinese government, in the Japanese government's view, likes to have Japan as a beating horse. They like to be able to point to Japanese atrocities as a way of deflecting attention from legitimacy problems or other political problems at home in China. Looking forward, Koizumi is going to be stepping down in the fall, and there is an array of prime minister hopefuls who've made their position on China more or less clear. Two are very strongly in favor, have pledged continued official visits to Yasukuni. Two have taken a much more conciliatory view towards China, but the polls show that the hardliners are far ahead, 70% in favor of Abe Shinzo, who's one of the hardliners. So what does this mean down the road? It seems to me that Japan has little chance of becoming the autarkic, militarist, dangerous state that it had become pre-World War II, because Japan is a democracy. I think in the short run there is this kind of nationalism that has very much irritated its neighbors. But because it's a democracy, I think that there will be information, there's contentious politics in response to what is viewed as unsuccessful policies. So I see Japan down the road returning to a more peaceable foreign policy in the region, but it's partly because the United States provides cover that the current administration has taken this hardline view, and I think the United States has a role to play in smoothing these relations in the region to the extent that the United States may want to do that. On the other hand, the United States kind of likes having Japan and China off balance in this way. Very briefly on Taiwan and Korea. Korea has taken a very different position towards China than Japan has. Korea is taking a more balanced view between Japan, between China and the United States, and if anything, has a more negative U.S., anti-U.S. view than an anti-China one. They feel that the Cold War is over, the United States is not helping Korea deal with its most important issues. They don't feel that North Korea is the threat that the United States portrays North Korea as being, and they are more keen on having a major country help to broker a reunification with North Korea. So very different stance towards China, warmer stance towards China. Taiwan, as you know, has very strong economic ties with China. The current administration of Taiwan is vocal and it has a high profile independence view, but the public on Taiwan, I think, favors the status quo. That is, they like having the economic integration with China, want to keep de facto political independence, and doesn't mind too much whether it's de jure independence or whether things are just on the current de facto basis. So, Ernesto.
Professor Zedillo.
Thank you. Well, I was assigned the homework of speaking about China and globalization. I must admit that in no way I'm not a specialist on China. And I will introduce my topic by saying that it is really a revealing irony that China, a country ruled by a Communist Party, and now we heard it this morning by a president who defined himself as a Marxist, is a country that has relied on capitalism, and in fact, on the most advanced form of capitalism, which is globalization, to undertake one of the greatest transformations in history, in modern history. Since the father of modern China, President Deng, launched his four modernization strategy at the Communist Party Central Committee meeting of December of 78, the Chinese economy has grown its size by a factor of 9, has lifted 400 million people out of extreme poverty, and has become the fourth largest economy if we measure its size by through current present exchange rates. But if we measure it through what economists call purchasing power parity, then it is already the second largest economy in the world. Well, even if the Chinese economy were to slow down to, let's say, 6%, China's economy will become the largest economy in the world by year 2030, which means, by the way, that not all, by many in this audience, will witness that moment in which China has the biggest economy in the world. Well, so what is so striking about China is that within a relatively short period of time, not only shifted from central planning to markets, but also from being a very closed economy, almost an autarkic economy, to a globally integrated economy. It has evolved from being closed to trade to being an economy as open to trade as most developed countries. And in fact, on some sectors, the Chinese economy is now more open than developed economies, you know, in agriculture, which is the most contentious, difficult issue for the multilateral trading system. Now China is more open than Europe and than the United States. The initial approach that they had of designating only certain areas as special economic zones open to foreign trade and investment, while the rest of the country was still socialist and close to economic foreign influence, has evolved within a few years into a foreign trade and investment regime that has transformed China into the single most open, large developing country in the world. I mean, China is now more open, certainly more open than India, which continues to be a very close country. China is more open than Brazil, and China is more open than Mexico, despite the fact that Mexico belongs to NAFTA. China is today the third largest trading country in the world, after the US and Germany, and probably in a few years will be the largest trading country in the world. And this trend, of course, was accelerated by China's accession to the WTO in late 2001. China is now importing $660 billion of goods and exporting $760. And relative to its GDP, its foreign trade is 70%. And this is incredibly high. Particularly when you take into account that not too many years ago, trade was only 5% of GDPs of the GDP of China, and the proportion of trade relative to GDP in China is twice the ratio of the United States and more than three times the ratio of Japan. And China's absorption of foreign investment has also been very impressive. There is a stock of foreign investment accumulated in China of $600 billion. This ratio, if you take the value of foreign investment in China relative to its GDP, is a ratio of 33%, is three times higher than the ratio for the US. So in terms of foreign investment, China is three times as open as the United States. It's four times higher than the ratio for South Korea, and 18 times higher than the ratio for Japan. So when I read this morning, you know, FT, Financial Times, and say, you know, the U.S. asked China to be more open, I say, okay, they can be more open, and I think it will be good for China to be more open to trade and investment, but they are terribly open already. So I don't think it's a very pressing issue in that respect. China has also become an important international investor. China will have, by the end of this year, and perhaps earlier, $1 trillion of international reserves. And most of those reserves, by the way, are invested in this country, because China has decided to invest heavily into U.S. bonds and into U.S. Treasury bonds. So China has a lot of confidence on the American economy. Of course, there are still aspects of the Chinese economy that have to be further open. The Chinese still have non-convertibility of the yuan. They still have restrictions on the investments that individuals can make abroad. But relatively to the situation of a few years ago, the openness of China is just striking. So I like to say that it is not an exaggeration that in recent years, not only has globalization driven China, but also that China has driven globalization. We wouldn't see the globalization that we are seeing today without China, and we wouldn't see the China of today without globalization. And this is very interesting because it poses a lot of challenges for China, but also for the United States, for the international system, and for the rest of the world. Due to the sheer size that the Chinese economy has reached, China has a unique feature that, by the way, was emphasized this morning by President Hu, and it's almost a paradox. And this paradox is very frequently overlooked in the West. China is now both a great economic power and is still a very poor country. This is something that we tend to overlook. Its per capita income of only $1,400 in 2005 is 1/30th of that of the United States. And as President Hu mentioned this morning, we were going to look at the rank of countries in terms of its per capita GDP. He kept saying, well, you know, it's below 100th. Well, I look at some statistics, and China is 118th in the world. So this is the irony. It's a great economic power, but it's still a very poor country. And a poor country that has to manage a lot of internal and external pressures in this new status that it has acquired in very few years. I'm not going to go into those challenges, that internal challenges of development of China. I think some were mentioned by the Chinese president. Some were mentioned by my colleagues here, you know, and I think I am in agreement with everything they said. Well, I also mentioned that the U.S. has also a serious challenge on how to manage its relationship with China. We have been hearing recently the most judicious people in the administration, without being aggressive, say, well, you know, China has to be a responsible stakeholder of the international system. Well, and that, I think, it's fine. There's good reason to say that. China is too important for not being responsible. But the problem is that there is not, and there cannot be, an established standard of what it means to be a responsible stakeholder within the global order. And no country, certainly not China, is rather ready to accept a unilateral and arbitrary imposition of such a standard. And this is a problem, but a problem that has a solution. Because we humans know about dialogue, we know about negotiation, we know about mutual accommodation, and I think that is what has been happening between China and the United States in a fantastic way over the last 30 years. If you had told anybody, you know, in 1971, you will see a China fully integrated into the world economy, well, this is a country that only 5 or 3 years earlier was in the middle of the Cultural Revolution, committing the worst atrocities that you could think in terms of human rights, and with an economy that had no possibility, totally closed to the world and very aggressive towards the rest of the world. Well, the United States used its leadership to pursue the integration of China into the world economy. China has come into the international system, and that's the good news. Well, the bad news is that there is some work to be done in the future for China internally, addressing the problems that have been raised by my colleagues, and learning to live as a great economic power in the international system. And that's a problem for China, that's a problem for the United States. Well, the final point that I want to make is that indeed the U.S. and China have to solve many issues bilaterally. But I tend to believe that it's also in the interest of China and the United States try to shift as many of these issues into the international and multilateral arena. I think the U.S. and China will find it easier to deal with some of these complex issues if they put more into strengthening multilateral institutions. I mean, the U.S. Has an interest on issues like human rights, and that's a very legitimate interest. But I think things that, like those suggested by Dean Harold Koh, should be done. But I think it also will be better if the United States work more to strengthen the multilateral institutions and convince China to be a more positive contributor towards those multilateral institutions. And this is important for the two countries, but it is also fundamental for globalization, because globalization certainly needs free markets, certainly needs integration, but globalization also needs global governance that can only be provided by creating institutions. And for creating those institutions, you need diplomacy, you need understanding, and you need leadership. And I think that's going to be the big challenge for China and the United States in the years to come, to create that global governance so that we can be in a world integrated in which conflict and war will be less likely to happen.
Well, I'd like to thank all of our speakers for starting us off and also for saying so much while managing to keep within their allotted time. It's not a skill for which professors are famous. We are now open to questions. We have two microphones here, and if you would have an interest in asking a question to one or several of the panelists, please come down to one of the microphones. As I said at the outset, we are looking for questions rather than interventions from the floor. So, first question over here.
Thank you all for your remarks. I was wondering, especially Professor Koh, what you thought the effectiveness of grassroots organizations like Amnesty International might have on human rights violations in China, or whether you think ultimately it has to come from economic and political leaders.
Okay, we will gather up a few questions before going to the panel.
Yes, if I may, I want to make two clarifications, very important one. One is what Professor Koh mentioned. I was also in the audience when President Hu spoke. What he said in the Chinese original was that 我是一个唯物主义者, literally meaning I am a materialist. And in the English translation, the translator apparently said something, and we can check the record, I am a materialist. And then he added something, I am a Marxist. So in the Chinese original, there is no Marxist at all. So we can double check that. Now, in the Chinese language, materialism has its own meaning. It basically means empirical materialism, which means an emphasis on experience or experiment. So I think that's a very important thing. I don't think a President Hu mentioned he was a Marxist. So that's the first point. Now the second point was with regard to the visit to Yasukuni Shrine. I don't think the Chinese have any problem with the visit to the Yasukuni Shrine, except the Yasukuni Shrine actually enshrines the dead of the Class A war criminals. And these war criminals were sentenced to death, not by the Chinese, but by the Far Eastern Military Tribunal, headed by the Americans. Thank you for the chance to make two clarifications. Thank you.
What did you say the word could have been? And it's not
I'm Mizuno from a Japanese journalist, and I have a question to Mr. Koh and President Cedillo about Chinese human rights and the relationship with the United Nations. Because the United Nations recently agreed to establish new Human Rights Council, and the United States is pushing, you know, China, all permanent five members to be council members. Do you think will it have a good positive effect on the Chinese attitude with human rights, or do you think is it good for United Nations to make a China as a council member of human rights?
Yeah, over here.
although we speak of where the Chinese economy will be by 2020 or 2030, I was just wondering, how is China going to weather the impact of a rapidly aging population created in part by the one-child policy?
Okay, one more and then we'll go back to the panel.
Okay, my question is addressed to Dean Harold Cole, and I admire what you said about human rights in China, and I definitely think that the police and the legal system should need more law enforcement. But I think every country will only do what is beneficial for them, no matter how great the outside pressure or the internal pressure is. And for someone, although I'm not very knowledgeable about the Falun Gong, but for someone, the leader, to claim that he himself is the reincarnation of the Buddha, and the Dalai Lama being a spiritual leader who is also a reincarnation of the previous Dalai Lamas. And this is very powerful spiritual leaders that can motivate the people to do whatever they want them to do. And such leaders can be very dangerous to the national polity of a country, especially in the European history. Like, people, I think, break away from the Pope precisely because of this, because religion and political policies should be separated. So a question that, like, I think what you asked for, that, like, the fair treatment of the Tibetan Buddhists and also the Falun Gong practitioners should be more considered, because if a person who claims that he himself is a reincarnation of Jesus Christ, and I think that, and he happens to gather a big mass of people following him, and I think this would be considered a threat and a danger by any government in the Western world as well. So that's my question.
Okay, why don't we go back to the panel? Who would like to start? Professor Koh.
Let me take the questions to me in order. First, Amnesty International has played a very important role with regard to their specialty, which is prisoners of conscience. There are many prisoners of conscience. Those names had not been well chronicled, and through the work of Amnesty and others, there is now a database of names of people who are being unfairly detained, and the U.S. government is referring to that database. And now there's more continuity, because in the dialogues between the U.S. and China, the president or the secretary of state or the assistant secretary raises the same names over and over again until they get results and demand answers. And that's one of the things that the president did yesterday with regard to six names. And I think that it's that personalization of human rights violation that has been a key aspect of this. With regard to the point about Marxism or materialism, that's not the main point I was making. What President Hu said in response to the question, what is your strategy for promoting individual human freedom, is, I am a materialist. I believe that there is an economic base and a political superstructure. Now, what he didn't say is, you Westerners, your premise is human beings are born with certain inalienable rights, and we organize governments to protect and give freedom to those rights, so personal freedom is the basis for what we do. And we organize our government to advance that personal freedom. He was saying, we organize our government to advance our economic development, we give whatever personal freedom is necessary, and we don't have to follow your playbook. That's what he said. And that is a very fundamental difference of attitude. Now, he put in terms two things I had not heard until today. There is no modernization without democracy. That was a very important and good statement. Although democracy in a way that he was describing it, human rights according to law. And secondly, order, harmony and order, with order being emphasized. So in other words, piecemeal advancement was the notion that he was pressing, not some sort of broad approach. But the term scientific development means, I would say, Frank Sinatra, we'll do it our way, not your way. With regard to the other two points, China should not be a Human Rights Council member, because their human rights performance is in the lower 10% of the world, and Human Rights Council members should be countries whose performance is at the top rank. The United States, in the amazing unwisdom of this administration, is not seeking a seat on the Human Rights Council. That is amazing. The country of Eleanor Roosevelt doesn't want to be on the UN Human Rights Council. I think that should be immediately changed, and our administration has no justification for doing it. And then the final point, spiritual leaders like the Dalai Lama, well, I'm sorry, you know, we have a lot of spiritual leaders in this country who I don't follow, and we call that pluralism. And they can survive. They can survive. People can believe in spiritual things and not be threatening the stability of the government. The Dalai Lama is a Nobel Peace Prize winner and an engaged spiritual leader who represents a very significant group. And the Falun Gong is not originally, it's not a religion. It is a practice that coexisted with party membership. And it's the Chinese government which has said, you can only believe one thing, and that's our party ideology. And that's what's radicalized these people, many of whom had no political agenda.
Professor Zedia.
Well, on this issue of the Human Rights Council, well, I'm in agreement with what Professor Ko said, but I will add that, unfortunately, the attitude that the United States adopted towards the general and fundamental issue of United Nations reform has put the system in the very difficult circumstance it is now. A little bit more than a year ago, or actually since 2003, two and a half years ago, the Secretary General launched this initiative to reform seriously the United Nations. He asked a group of people to produce a number of proposals. He put his own proposals on the table for discussion in March of last year. And then, unfortunately, the US administration had a very withdrawn attitude. For a number of months, there was no ambassador to the UN. The US was not engaged at all in these negotiations. And at the last moment, the ambassador to the United Nations, from the part of the United States, presented a long list of objections about the document that had been discussed and negotiated for a long time. So the general perception was that the US was not interested in any reform. This perception was further confirmed when the US blocked any effort to introduce the issue of non-proliferation, which I think is the most serious issue for this country and for the world, nuclear proliferation. And all of that happened, the summit came, it was a failure. And I was a special envoy appointed by Kofi Annan, and I must say with shame and embarrassment that the summit was a total failure. One of the few issues that was modestly rescued in the declaration was this question of creating a Human Rights Council. And again, the United States played a very withdrawn attitude, position, and only at the end decided to do something about it, but it was too late. So we ended up with something which is not the original proposal, which put forward by Kofi Annan, which I think would have prevented some extravagant appointments to this new council. And I think now we are in risk of seeing countries that should not be in the council to be part of it. But I would put quite respectfully, you know, great responsibility on the U.S. Attitude. On this question of aging population, yeah, this is one of the great imbalances that China has. Population is getting to be old, and this is a country that has no social safety nets. And this is going to be a very serious problem. And that is why China needs to keep growing very fast. Otherwise, they will not have resources to confront this as well as other terrible imbalances that are being present in its development.
Professor Gewirtz.
I just want to make two comments. I very much agree with what Dean Koh said about both the substance and tone of President Hu's remarks this morning about doing it China's way. I was struck above all this morning by a sense of Hu presenting China as an equal at the bargaining table, an equal participant at the table. There was, yes, the invocation that we are the leading developing country and our per capita income is 100th, et cetera, but the substance, and I thought the tone was, we are the equals of the United States. There was not a sense of we're at a backward stage of development and eventually we will move to be equals. There was a tone and substance of we are equals. And on the political reform front, I didn't think that he was saying because of our stage of economic development, we can't have your kind of political reform, but in the future we will. He was saying we're going to do it our way. We will look to foreign experience, but we're going to do it our way, and it doesn't necessarily mean your way. So that's my first point. Second point is President Hu does not control China. Debbie began the panel's presentation by drawing our attention to the people, the bottom up, the forces that are happening in China. I think it's right to keep in mind, it's not only that there is a central government and there are local and provincial governments, there are also forces in play that it may not be possible for President Hu to control. And I don't think anyone in this room can predict exactly how things are going to play out. But on the issue of political reform or political restructuring, whatever words you want to use, it isn't all in President Hu's hands. There are experiments going on at the local level. There are rising expectations of the many forms that Professor Davis mentioned, and we just need to keep that in mind as we evaluate today.
Professor Davis.
That was before Paul spoke. I was just going to say China is not Hu Jintao, and it seemed our comments had stalled in a way at that level. One of the consequences of the destruction of the command economy, the kind of globally driven and engaged economy that Mr. Zidio has described, is that there is an organizational revolution in China, not only firm level, family business level, but associational level all over China. And this is the dynamic society in which these rising expectations are moving. And therefore, of course, it makes predictions impossible. But I did, thank you, want to get that back on the table and then take up the old age question that was asked from the floor. And again, build on what Mr. Zidio just said, take the next step, which is I see in the multiple ways in which this aging population and the sex ratio distortion and people's very profound dissatisfaction with the one-child policy forces of change. And we can see the ways in which Chinese citizens in many different ways within these new zones of indifference is one way to describe them, new arenas of public life are acting. So with this old age issue, we see retirees actually be the first groups that came forward with these protests. This has been going on for 10 years, and people are not afraid, and they have been actually effective, and they have changed policy, and it's not stopping. On the health side, where there's a crisis, again, one of the leading wedges is not necessarily elderly themselves as patients, but as what passed Social Security in the United States, and Medicare in the United States, the middle-aged children of elderly people who find themselves in a tremendous vise right now, unable to provide the care that is on the market, and they can't provide it for their families. So I think this is another way in which we can understand how China will move forward in this context of citizens demanding more of their government.
If anyone else would like to pose questions, could they please approach the microphones? And while that's people are doing that, I thought I would just pose a question to the panelists, shifting focus a little bit to some of the political economy of the remarks this morning, and some of the building a little bit on some of the remarks Professor Davis just made. And my question really goes to the macro political economic projections that are being thrown around both in President Hu's speech and in some of the commentary we've seen. And it really has two parts to it. The first, and this is really for anybody on the panel, is how much stock should we put in these projections of what the Chinese economy will be doing in 2020 or 2030 and so on. A lot of it seems to me just based on a linear extrapolation of 9% growth into the future. You know, it wasn't that long ago in the mid to late 1980s people were using such extrapolations to predict that the Japanese were going to take over the world economy and displace the U.S. And we know what that looked like not very much later. And then also on the downside, the sort of China still being a very poor country, 100th in per capita GDP, and so on. But on the other hand, if they began significantly revaluing their currency, that picture could change very well. So the first question is, how much stock should we really put in these broad brush predictions for the Chinese economy? And then the second question, which is the larger theoretical question that flows out from this. Are we, in President Hu's speech this morning, he spent quite a bit of time talking about China's distinct development path, which was going to involve, among other things, managing the emerging inequalities, the industrial rural inequalities, and the geographic inequalities between the coastal regions and the interior. But just building on the observation that it's not that the political leadership may have a limited capacity to actually control the development that's occurring in China, what sort of development model are we looking at? Is this going to be Brazil writ large? Is it going to be some other development model, or is it really the case that we're in uncharted waters here? So if anyone would like to pick up that, Professor Koh.
I think an important point about this visit is that the actual agenda between the two countries on many issues will not move forward. That's the message from yesterday. What President Bush was looking for, reduction of the trade deficit, help on weapons of mass destruction, help on Iran, help on North Korea, human rights, he got nothing. So what is the purpose of this visit? This is about President Hu introducing himself to four audiences. One is President Bush, who he's met four times already, and he knows that this is a lame duck administration. The second is other countries, as Francis mentioned, and showing, as Paul said, that he's an equal. The third is the Chinese people, showing that vis-a-vis Jiang Zemin, who made a big trip here, that he is an equal stature with a different kind of leadership capacity at the global level. And then finally, and this is the major message of all this, the audience is American business, to persuade them that China is moving forward and that therefore the Bill Gateses of the world and the Boeings should feel comfortable investing to promote this economic development engine. And he wants to give them a slogan, scientific development, which he's calling balanced, sustainable, people-oriented, our way, not necessarily adhering to universal human rights standards, but adhering to WTO standards. And that's what we're going to do. Now, I think that the thing that struck me the most as a former government official, those of you who are in the room, just before President Hu came in, all of these other people came in. They were the same people who came in with Jiang Zemin in 1998. Those people have not changed. The playbook is the same. But what President Hu is putting on it is his personal stamp. And he did do some things that I thought were quite striking. Coming to Yale, reaching out to us at a personal level, inviting us, saying we want this kind of educational exchange and people-to-people diplomacy. That sounds like part of his image of scientific development. Now, I agree very much with Deborah, who is not China, but he's putting a face on it that I think will be very significant. Until today, or until this trip, most Americans didn't know what he was like. He seemed like a technocrat. Now he has expressed a vision.
Well, on these economic projections, let me insist again where China is today. If you think about Japan in 1950, a country devastated by the Second World War, well, China today, its GDP per capita relative to the US is lower than it was Japan's per capita GDP relative to the US in 1950. I mean, that's the problem that that China has. And that's why China is insisting in growing economically first and then trying to solve other problems later. Whether the strategy will work, I don't know. But I think China has, the Chinese leadership have very clear in their mind that if they don't get their economy to grow more, then they are going to be in a very deep social trouble once they have integrated the way they have integrated into the world economy. So I would say that as long as they keep a very high savings rate, they don't need to keep it as high as it is now, almost 50% of GDP. It could fall to as low as 30% of GDP, but becomes a more productive economy, because right now China has a very unproductive economy. You know, for we economists, we are not surprised that China is growing that much. We are surprised why it's growing so little. Because a country that invests more than 40% of its GDP should be growing 22%. They still have very serious problems of productivity. But they are working at that. Every year you see some progress. So I don't see why, unless there's a major global conflict, I don't see why China's economy will not be the biggest of the world in 2030. Even then, Chinese per capita income will be one-fourth of that of the United States. But of course, they will be much better off. What development model they are following? Well, the Chinese model, based on capitalism, to have a very fast growing economy, and certainly de-emphasizing other aspects. But I think my understanding of what the Chinese president said is a little bit different of what my colleagues listen there. The first thing I would say, well, you know, no politician will ever say, you know, I'm going to copy your own way of thinking. Because the day you say that, I think you should be out of office, even if you are in a non-democratic country, as it is China. So I think it's very naive to say the Chinese president is going to come to the States and say, oh yes, I just discovered that the only way to be free and the only way to be democratic is to be exactly as Americans have done it. I mean, that's impossible. I mean, by definition. But having said that, I think the president was saying, yes, I understand that the more prosperous we are in the economy,
we will have to do something on the political front. But give us a break, you know. I approve of that. I don't necessarily. I mean, as president of Mexico, I bet on democracy. And many people said to me, you know, it's going to be terrible for the economy if we stop being or stop having a rather authoritarian political system. I think it's going to be good for Mexico, be great for Mexico. But I cannot say I have no moral authority whatsoever to tell the Chinese, you better copy the Mexican or the American way of thinking. I couldn't do that.
Professor Rosenblum.
Yeah, I just want to put a quick addendum on that. I agree that moral imperialism is not what we should be after. But on the other hand, I think that governments can make massive allocative mistakes when they try to do things centrally. And the idea that the Chinese government is going to do things better than a freer system, I think we should take with a grain of salt. And it's often the case that when governments pick winners, they are politically motivated. These are not necessarily economically motivated decisions. So I would be a little more skeptical about the long-run potential of an economy that's managed too much through state-owned enterprises and so on.
Just on this question about the models, Ian's question, as I summarized it, I was thinking of very regionally, it's a choice between South Korea and the Philippines. That's the kind of options that you can, that I think, represent the turning point in the road where they might go.
Okay, we'll take another round of about five questions from the floor. We'll alternate again. Yeah.
I would like the panel to address a little bit more the rising wage inequality. I mean, you're sort of talking about regional differences. And in particular, I'd love to know to what extent the Communist Party still deserves its name, Communist. I.e., are there any attempts of the party to combat the social inequality? Is that taken seriously? And to what extent do trade unions, labor unions, play a role in this? And is there, do you see any progress from the party standpoint with regard to their sort of negative, antagonistic approach to trade unions? Thanks.
This question is addressed to Professor Gewurz and Dean Ko. If I assume we are trying to push China towards two directions. One, a democracy. Second, protection of civil rights, human rights. These may not necessarily be compatible. If we assume that China should be a democracy, which is admittedly a big if, then we should also agree that you should not push civil rights against the people, against their own will. Even in the United States, there was no effective protection of civil rights, of racial equality until 1964 when there were clear election results. So in China, we are sure, I would assume, that people want a rule of law, people want freedom of speech, and people would like less social inequality. We are not sure that people support the Falun Gong, people would like government tolerance of the Falun Gong, and we're not sure that they would allow more freedom of religion at all. So even if I personally do not support these sentiments, what are we going to do to combat the own resistance within the Chinese people?
Hi. I have to come back again after hearing your opinions about China. And I agree with what you said about President Hu's agenda here in the United States. Today, he definitely said that because there's, I think, deep down a foundational difference between the China and the West. The point being, we set up our government not in order to protect individual freedom, but rather to sustain a national development. And I think he is constantly referring to the perseverance of Chinese people today. And I think he is hoping that the Chinese people would pull together and manage through this hard time. And I think that And also you mentioned the question like of how he want himself to be perceived at when he steps down from office. And I think the Chinese traditionally, as he also said today during the speech, that we have a culture that is distinct from West. And traditionally, I think our leaders have always been thinking in terms of the larger picture rather than himself. So, and also about the individuals, like less of the individuals, but rather the nation at large. And therefore, and I think that like the United States or the other Western countries trying to push China to think that their government, the purpose of their government is to protect individual freedom, is sort of trying to assert this new ideology on a country that has been running on their own ideology of national unity and harmony for thousands of years. And isn't this a tyranny of the majority? It's not really democracy. Thanks.
Hi, I have my question is mainly directed towards Professor Gortz and Professor Ko. I guess economically we've seen that China seems to have proven that you can run a fairly decent market economy and have authoritarian structures. I suppose my question is related to law reform and the rule of law. If President Hu actually is sincere about pushing forward the rule of law, and even possibly if he can't control it because of the expansion of law reform, to what degree a lot of people think that the rule of law is internally connected to human rights and to democracy. So I guess, what do you think the potential is of this growing legal movement along with sort of global, and its connection to the global judiciary of possibly creating a destabilizing pro-democracy change? I guess I quickly want to point to the example, and Professor Gortz can expand on it, of the sort of inadvertent case of judicial review that happened last year with the lower level judge and the seats and that happened.
I just have a few comments about the human rights issue. The example raised by Professor Ko are actually based on organization which are anti-China or anti-Chinese government. So I'm just a little concerned that the analysis from those examples would be exaggerated. I mean, would exaggerate the signal to noise ratio about the China human rights issue. By saying that, I'm not here to justify China's human rights issue. I mean, human rights status. I'm just hoping that a human rights researcher could go to China and listen more to what Chinese people said rather than just a very small portion of people saying outside of China. And so that you can get a better picture, a whole picture of the China human rights issue. I'm just hoping that human rights issue will not be abused or utilized by a political organization to criticize China for a non-human right objections. Objective.
Thank you. I'd like to pose a question first to Dean Ko and ask what role can and more importantly, what role should U.S. businesses such as Google, Yahoo, Microsoft, or European businesses like Airbus play in the development of China's economy and the sort of marriage of their economic development with their human rights development? How can they balance their own personal business interests with the interests of, say, Boeing and Airbus competing for a contract of 250,000 planes in the next 20 years?
Last question.
Hey, my name is Zhao. I'm from China. I studied in Europe and the US. Probably I still need more master my English. Anyway, talking about human rights and democracy, I have a family living there. Nobody loves them more than we do. But actually, from the current situation in China, I think we cannot afford it. And I have a question also of talking about the Japanese-China relations. People here, we say the China future cannot be predictable, but I think China's future can be predictable. It really depends a lot on the U.S. reactions. And so how to U.S. react to China is very crucial. Talking about Japan recently behaved quite strange, I think, in the international world. That's one reason is because many Japanese people try to recover their military status and nuclear power. I think so. This is one reason. That's why they try to go to visit the criminal temples. So I have a question here asking the professors. In German, thinking about in the World War II, Japanese war criminals did a lot of bad things, even worse than German war criminals. So if German chancellor go to worship Adolf Hitler, what the U.S. will react? Thank you.
We're running short on time, so what I would like to do now is to invite each of the panelists to both respond to any of the questions that they think they can illuminate that have come up, and add into the mix any final comments they would like to leave us with. And so we can perhaps go in the reverse order that we did before, President Zedillo.
Well, I think I will just say that all the issues that have been raised about what is wrong with China today are right. I mean, there's good reason in all these arguments. And I noticed one of the questions by one of the students said, you know, what is the role that companies that are heavily engaged in China, and it was suggesting somehow that perhaps if those companies were going to less do in China, that would be an instrument for pressure. Well, the problem with that kind of argument is that if we take them to the extreme, then we seem to be thinking that isolation is the solution. I mean, all of us are worried about human rights and political freedom. But the question is, how is more likely to see China not only as a fully engaged country in the global economy as it is today, but also as a country that shares more of the political vision that prevails in the West? Is that going to happen through isolation, or is that going to happen more likely through engagement, through interaction, to interdependence, through globalization? And my bet would be certainly for the second approach. I think we are now much better positioned to see not only a highly prosperous, but also a democratic, total free China many years from now. Of course, not tomorrow. But we are now much better positioned to see that than we were 20 or 30 years ago by the simple fact that China has become integrated into the world economy. And this is not a new idea. This idea has been around for many centuries. You know, there was a famous great Englishman, Cobden, great diplomat, who said, trade is God's diplomacy. And I think trade will be that powerful instrument to integrate China, not only economically, but also to make China more like us, and hopefully to make us more like China.
Professor Rosenbluth.
Well, I think my comments follow on that, that despite the political rancor among China's neighbors, between China and Japan in particular, the fact that the countries are prospering from each other economically provides a kind of security that these countries are going to work things out. And I don't worry that Japan is going to rise again as a military power. I think this concern is misplaced. I think Japan is seeking some kind of political independence in the wake of the Cold War, and is trying to find its way, what kind of state it wants to be, a normal state. despite the fact that the U.S. rewritten Constitution of Japan has an article in it that says we forever renounce the sovereign right to wage war. I expect that Japan will change its constitution. Japan may become a nuclear power, but I don't think that Japan is going to become an aggressive power. And the economic prosperity is one of the important pieces of that tissue and glue that's holding peace together.
Professor Koh.
Well, one overarching point which answers a number of the questions and also responds to my colleague Ernesto Zedillo. Nobody is asking China to copy anybody else. Human rights is no longer the property of any one country in the world. One reason I was appointed Assistant Secretary of State for Human Rights was so that when I went into meeting with Chinese and they say, guess what, Asians don't believe in human rights, I could say, I don't think so. We could review the Confucian or the Buddhist or the Taoist traditions. A Chinese person was one of the drafters of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. These are now global concepts. And if China wants to be part of the global system, it has to accept global standards. And that it is accepting WTO standards, it needs to accept global standards on anti-corruption, and it needs to accept global standards on human rights, because that is the coin of the realm. And that is what you did not hear from President Hu, somehow the suggestion that it might be possible to do this when he used certain words. In the State Department, this moment, they are doing a content analysis of his speeches. And the words he used were peace, good, development, good, human progress, good, then harmony, order, not much about individual freedom, not much about tolerance, not much about pluralism. And those are the values that, at the end of the day, will be important here. He said at one point, there's no melody with one note, there's no painting with one song, with one color. There's also no sustainable development without serious protection of personal as well as economic freedom, and that is the point that really needs to be made. Now, with regard to the points that follow, what role does rule of law play? Legal remedies give individuals the capacity to create personal space and personal areas of freedom. What role do businesses play? Well, the 2008 Olympics is a huge opportunity where many, many American businesses are going to be operating. If they insist on adhering to higher labor standards and paying higher wages and demanding higher levels of freedom for their employees, they can have a tremendous impact on this whole area. So my bottom line here is global standards, entering the global marketplace by adhering to global standards. And that is not imposition of anybody else's values. That's what China needs to do if it wants to be a serious global player.
Professor Gawar.
I see we have 2 minutes left, and I genuinely have to leave at 5 o'clock. So let me just say, in response to the question about rule of law, the effort to enhance the rule of law in China is certainly not centrally about or exclusively about economics. It is closely connected to human rights and democracy. And what is fascinating to watch legal reform in China is that law has become a discourse through which issues of human rights and greater democratization can be expressed in a somewhat safer way. And so it is a terrain of complexity, but also one of possibility.
Professor Davis.
Just quickly on the inequality question. It is indeed reaching now, it reached U.S. standards a few years ago, and it seems now it will meet Brazilian standards if we look at income. It's a very serious problem, and actually this group, led by Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao, have made inequality a key piece, and they have reduced the taxes on the poorest. They have put in better coverage for social benefits in the last 2 years. What's striking to me as an American is to hear how informed the Chinese leadership are about inequality, how much they care about it, how much of their rhetoric actually responds to it. However, on the question of whether unions have been effective in pushing on those issues, in general the answer would be no. But then I turn again to those actors who are not in the public light now, but who are daily becoming more numerous. And on the factory floor, there is definitely a surge of empowered workers who are very increasingly brave. And that's why when I said whether they'll go the South Korean or the Filipino route, which is one of the things I see, when I think of what South Koreans did to produce their current political economy, that's where I would say I hope that China will also look.
Well, before drawing these proceedings to a close, it just remains for me to thank the audience for coming and participating, and of course, above all, thank our panelists for starting a discussion which we will all continue.